And now I present to you James P. Madonna and the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman.
Okay. Better late than never.
Finally.
Welcome to Progressive Discussions. We could not do the show as per scheduled Saturday afternoon because it happens to be a Sunday afternoon because there were some work that needed to be done in the newsletter censored research center here in northeastern New Jersey. Mm-hmm. Plumbing and if you didn't already notice, lighting. We have a very beautiful, large, brand new LED office fixture, and I can see the difference. I'm sure you people out there that have enough brain cells and have halfway decent eyeballs, eyesight, can also see the difference. I like it. But I have LED at home, so, you know, I know about LEDs. They will take over. They are taking over, and rightfully so. They are much more energy efficient. They run cooler, and they're brighter. Hey, the aquarium lighting, mm-hmm. full spectrum lighting for all LEDs. Gotta love it. I actually, my last incandescent nightlight bulbs burnt out last night, and I replaced them with LED nightlights. And I left it on. I didn't shut it off. I left it on. I put my hand on. I touched it. It was room temperature. Yeah. Why shut it off? It's a freaking LED. You know what I mean? It's a little LED. The life on them is incredible. I know I'm doing a promo for LEDs, but you know what?
Yeah, sure.
We're big on science here at Progressive Discussions. We love science. Can't stop science, like George Costanza said on Seinfeld. Can't stop it. No way, no how. Can't stop science. Seven bells for science and high technology. If you watch Ancient Aliens, you will see just how far and how rapidly we are advancing in terms of technology. Anyway, I'm here with my co-host and mentor and the very founder of Newsletter Censored in 1977, the one and only, the Pope of the Internet, the Archbishop of the Cosmos, the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman. How are you feeling this Sunday, sir?
Humble.
All right, good. Now, just want to say real quick, everything we discuss politically is part of our series, Capitalism in a Conch Shell. That's right, Capitalism, C-R-A-P, Capitalism in a Conch Shell. Let's see if King Neptune has anything to say. Hey, what's going on? Yeah, I know we're supposed to do the show on Saturday, but, you know, what can you do? Unforeseen perils sometimes pop up, you know, yeah, you remember the old saying,
Well, you don't remember it.
Hama. Oh, I gotta do the saying right. Sky's red in the morning, the sailor's warning, sky's red at No, wait a minute. Yeah, sky red in the morning, a sailor's warning. Sky red at night, a sailor's delight. Yeah, that's right, that's right. I don't want to screw it up because I'm talking to Neptune. Yes, yes, I will get into that very, very comical news that seems to be the rave in particular cities that received it. All right, no problem. Yes, Donald Trump's naked statues.
They pulled it down.
They did? Why?
At Little Dick.
The one with the
little dick.
Little tiny sack of balls and a little shrunken penis? Hey, it shrinks! The water was cold. The water.
Oh, man.
He did a George Costanza. Supposedly, probably the oligarch that's backing the Hillary campaign commissioned the artist, the sculptor, to make these very comical, supposedly life-size statues of Donald Trump naked. And certain cities received it, like New York, and of course all the tourists took photos in front of it, and they were making fun of his genitalia. And I think it's part of the fact that anything to humiliate her opponent and take votes away from her opponent, anything to get elected, Hillary Clinton's campaign will stop at nothing. And the people that pull the puppet strings, the oligarch, will stop at nothing because, I mean, I've seen photographs of some of the wealthiest top 1%, and man, they look like walking a sarcophagus. I mean, they look. I've seen better looking mummies in Egyptian tombs. It's almost like they're keeping themselves alive
to aggravate
the world, yeah. To piss people off, and it's
But soon they will be gone.
Know, with all the, you know, they can afford all the heart transplants, the organ transplants mm-hmm. they want. They can afford to grow organs in the lab, which they're doing. They it's almost like they're clinging to life really hard. Maybe they're afraid of meeting their maker. These the world's wealthiest people that pull the puppet strings. Maybe they don't want to meet their maker. Maybe they're afraid of meeting their maker.
They don't believe in the maker, number one.
Well, where are they going to go when they die? That's it.
Well, that's it. Yeah, but for them, they think they can take it with them, or they can at least give it to their family.
Well, I think scientists, like quantum physicists, like that, the ones that appear on Ancient Aliens, I think they believe in parallel universes, other dimensions. I think they believe that there is something that lives on somehow. They just don't know. They don't know anything. Just like people that represent religions, all the organized religions and religions of the world that cause more strife and trouble for humanity than any other factor. They have their beliefs on what happens when you die, and nobody has proven it. But they sure as hell want to spend taxpayers' money on these religions.
Well, that's why it's up to the poor person to find out the truth. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good.
Now they took down the naked statues of Trump
in New York. I didn't know he was anywhere else.
It was causing too much of a stir.
Obviously.
Traffic, and
put
in Times Square.
The grotesqueness of it.
Could it
offended people?
Could you imagine Times Square, 42nd Street? 8th Avenue,
naked cowboy.
Where all the naked cowboy, he's got a little speedo.
Whatever.
Where all the tourists go, Midtown Manhattan. Yeah. That's the place for it because it's jammed with people mm-hmm. walking to and fro constantly. It's never ending. It's like it's more. It's like an ant farm, for God's sakes. It's like people going, excuse me, every which way. Put the statue there. You don't have to worry about jamming anything, you know? Plus, it's a tourist area. I mean, yes, it was grotesque, but it was funny, you know? I mean, they don't arrest topless women in New York anymore.
Maybe Mr. Trump didn't like it.
Mr. Trump, knowing his ego, probably totally flipped out with these statues being in different areas. And of course, if they would have made him look like Michelangelo's David, he probably would
David
not.
David had a little dick, too.
Well, you know, if the dick was... Listen, there are ancient statues with big schlongs.
I never saw one.
I've seen them, but their primitive cultures do that. Japanese ancient
big balls.
Ancient Japanese erotic art from back in the days of the shoguns and everything. They all have big schlongs.
Yeah.
So maybe they're trying to compensate.
That's a projection. You know?
Yeah, of what they really wish
really
they
would like.
What they like, what they wish they had, right. Yeah. But anyway, I notice patterns. Now, in this case, different teabaggers, when I say teabagger, I mean a right-wing conservative person that votes Republican that is not wealthy. Okay. Put it in simple layman's terms. My brother-in-law's father had said to me when we were talking about single-payer universal health care and doing away with these insurance companies and everyone will get free health care. He says, who's going to pay for all this? Okay, now... Bill Morrow said in response, our commercial voiceover artist says to me Friday, when I was having coffee with him and with other people, he says concerning free education, public universities, who's going to pay for the expenses of the professors, their salaries, and blah, 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 blah. Okay. Similar statement by Bill Morrow. But one was healthcare, one was free education, college education. Now, other teabaggers online say to me, and more than one said this, the problem with, because I had mentioned the fact that Scandinavian countries, you don't see Scandinavian immigrants in the United States. You don't never hear about people from Scandinavia relocating to the United States. Oh, gee, I wonder why. So, what they said to me was that the problem with democratic socialism is that, or socialism in general, is that eventually you will run out of other people's money. Well, my answer to them and to Bill Morrow and to my brother-in-law's father is this. You tax the rich. That's how you get the money for the single-payer universal health care and the free public universities.
Well, that's how it used to be. That's how the government makes money, gets money. But the point of that whole thing is
revenue.
We have a misallotment of money today.
Yeah.
Meaning the money goes to profitable corporations, the money goes to tax cuts for the rich.
Yeah.
The money goes to 800 military bases around the world. We don't realize that every dollar spent in one of those bases and not in the United States, robs our economy.
We were discussing this during the week. You're absolutely right. The businesses that are in these foreign countries near and around these bases, they are getting the cash from these American military personnel. They're spending their money there. Mm-hmm. They're not putting their money back into the American economy.
No, they're not.
They're putting it back into the economy of that country.
There's plenty of money for universal health care and free education and an annual income.
Like Norway's doing.
Okay.
A base.
There's plenty of money.
A base income.
Misallotted, that's all.
Right.
Misallocated, excuse me.
And, you know, with the corporate welfare and with the... of, you know, all these bailouts and subsidies and what have you, and the corporations not paying taxes, federal income taxes,
and fraud, one, and waste. Come on.
Right now, one of the gentlemen that was having coffee with us Friday was a tourist from Holland, from the Netherlands, and he spoke very good English. With an accent, of course, but he, the young man, very, very different from the young millennials in the United States. This guy was a sharp cookie, man. He was smart and mature too. He was telling me that he is in the Netherlands military. He's a fighter jet mechanic. He is a jet aircraft mechanic. He was young, he was 20 something, and he was telling me about how it is. Yeah, he says it's all these basic things that really humans need and deserve, we get.
That's correct.
You know, and he says the base, he thinks the base salary, which is true, regardless what Republicans tell you, yeah, Norway or maybe more countries are given a base monthly salary just to give you a decent head start in life, you know. And then if there's, you know, if you have a baby, you get adequate paternity and maternity leave. Mm-hmm. You get adequate vacation. You have adequate everything. You don't have to retire in poverty, for God's sakes. So
they treat their people like people instead of the capitalistic system, which treats people as wage slaves. Come on! Understand what's going on.
Ever since the Industrial Revolution, they have treated the masses like they were horses pulling a plow on a farm.
Cogs in the wheel of industry, that's all.
Yeah.
Cogs,
you know, unless you're wealthy, then you have all the value in the world as a human being, you know. And, of course, if you're a baby in the womb, you have tons of rights for Republicans. But if you're born, unless you have a silver spoon in your mouth, you're not worth a damn once you're born.
That's right.
Now, see, this is it. There, where is the money going to come from? Who's going to pay for all this? You numbskulls. The rich are going to pay for it. That's how you do it. You know, I mean, it's really simple. It's not complicated.
No, it's not.
And
but they make it so that you won't be able to... To argue about it.
Yeah, no, you won't
run... Accept what is.
You won't run out of other people's money because the rich will be paying their fair share in income taxes.
Revenue will keep cycling into the government. On and on and on
and
on.
And if you
just
keep...
like now.
And if you keep the jobs in the United States, the extra money that the American consumer has... The more surplus cash the American consumer has, the more he puts back into the economy. The little guy I'm talking about puts back into the economy, which stimulates the economy. instead of stimulating the economy of all those foreign countries. And come on, 800 bases. That sounds like trying to occupy the world.
Well, yeah, that's what it is. Colonialism.
Yeah.
Under a different name, that's all it is.
And it, you know, isn't it funny?
In Italy, of course, they work with the Cosa Nostra, they work with the Camorra, they work with all the organized crime.
Now, isn't it funny how the modern-day descendants of Ephraim and Manasseh are always the culprits in this obsession with greed and power, colonialism, exploitation of people that they feel are inferior to them, that are not like them, murdering them.
You mean like the little brown people?
People of color. Yeah, it's always the, when I say the modern day descendants of Ephraim and Manasseh, I'm talking about Great Britain and the United States, which is the offspring of the British Empire. You know, the Caucasian folk, the European colonialism, colonial way of thinking, of stealing by force and taking by extortion, and then having a representative of the Catholic Church with them as they steal the land and the gold and everything from the country. They called it the New World. For God's sakes, the native people in the so-called New World have been around for thousands of years, and Europeans were living in caves, and they're calling at that time, you know, when the Incas and they all had empires, and they're calling the people of the Americas the New World, mm-hmm. and savages, mm-hmm. because they're not like them. Mm-hmm. You know how advanced the Mayans and the Incas and all these people were when Europe was going through the Dark Ages.
Mm-hmm. Turn on a light. Turn on a light, please!
Oh, you don't have enough light? But anyway.
And remember, those bases, the bases, they've let's just take Diego Garcia. They kicked the goddamn inhabitants out of the island and into poverty.
Yeah.
And they do that all the time, and they take land, they don't buy it. They take it they think it belongs to them. You know, us. I'm talking us. We think it's in Honduras or some other country. We think it belongs to us.
Right.
Okay.
Well, do a little Chisler's Hall of Shame. Did I mention the highway robbery of getting your medical records out of the hospital last week?
Yes,
I already did that. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So, I'm going to be doing a separate Chisler's Hall of Shame, bashing the exotic pet industry. You know, it seems like when it comes to, see, to me, retail, American retail has to be the sleaziest, most underhanded, you know, form of business. As the nail sticketh between two stones, so does sin stick to buying and selling.
Mm.
That's in the Bible.
I believe that's Ecclesiastes 27, verse 2.
Something like that. And anything that is considered in America a specialty, it could be boating supplies, it could be RV, you know, recreational vehicle supplies, anything that supports a particular hobby. In other words, the non-essentials of life, it's the prices are marked up to the high heavens. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, well, no, more often now, because companies are deregulated, you have very, very bad customer service. You know, and a little rigging too, like I mentioned that time about the new wave oven. You know, the dome, once the dome lid breaks, yeah, they want you to buy a whole new wave oven. They don't have the dome, the replacement part of the dome. And without the dome lid, you can't cook anything.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So things like that, you know, built-in obsolescence in American appliances, where the lifespan of the appliance does not last long at all. And we've done that in the past many times with toasters and coffee makers and what have you. My coffee maker burnt out, American made. It went kaput. All right. So now I'm making coffee the old-fashioned way, pouring it in the Melita, you know, in the I have a washable filter basket made of fine metal mesh that I got at Walmart, and I put the coffee in there and I pour it and it drips down. Hey, I'm tired of buying appliances that don't last, that mysteriously die, suddenly die on you, you know. So that's a humongous Chiseler's Hall of Shame right there, product wise. Mm-hmm. But I will do a separate a Chiseler's Hall of Shame on the exotic pet industry, because it's a specialty, non-essential industry, and they fuck you over, and the customer service sucks. And of course, only in America do you have this crap. But I do want to salute LED lights. I do have to do that. I have to salute that. I also want to say greetings to my near dear friend in Osaka, Japan, from Osaka, Japan, Miho. Hello, Miho. The creator himself, personal trainer and nutritional consultant extraordinaire, Mr. Mario Petrus. Saw my administrators, all of my top administrators of the Facebook group, Sasha Boyle, Anthony Laura, Mick Von Raven, Scatman, the Scatman, I call him.
Scatman Crothers.
No, not Scatman Crothers, this guy's Caucasian. He knows who he is, the Scat Man. Melissa Coates, professional wrestler and former competitive bodybuilder. Greetings, shout out. Of course, Evelyn Pringle, a true progressive warrior. And, did you see those cute photos of Jill Stein with her male cat, her orange tabby? That she had, she had pictures taken of the cat getting in between her and her Apple laptop. Like, the cat wouldn't let her do anything.
Aha, uh-huh, join the club.
Big male, big fluffy male, orange tabby, wouldn't let her do anything. I had to put that on one of my groups because it was funny. It was cute, too. I think Melissa Coates has a, belongs to her. It looks like, I think it's a Persian. I could be wrong.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't have the flat face of a Himalayan, but it has the bulk. It could be a Persian, but it has a face and the hair looks like a lion. It looks like a baby lion.
It's Persian.
It has that regal look to it.
It's Persian.
You could tell, like, the males, you know. Mm-hmm. But this one has a very lion-like look to it. Real cute. But anyway, that's basically it. For my shout-outs. Of course, I can't remember everybody.
Yeah.
I mean, what the hell do you want, man? I have a new group. My sixth group is called the St. Valentine's Day Massacre on Our Wallets, male activists group. Oh, Mr. Ronald King, yes, my friend, and male rights activist and administrator.
Extraordinaire.
Extraordinaire. I don't even know if he is. No, he's not an administrator. I think he's a moderator, but I don't even know. Hey, I got so much going on, I can't remember everything, all the details. But everybody that's in my organization, I give a shout out to. Seven bells for all of them. So, supposedly Julian Assange of WikiLeaks is going to really lower the boom this October 2016. We shall see. They keep on mentioning. He also has dirt on George Soros and the Rothschilds. Supposedly, Vladimir Putin has an international arrest warrant out for the Rothschilds and George Soros. And between WikiLeaks and, you know, whatever information Evelyn Pringle had posted, that they feel a lot of the puppets, the Hillary Clinton puppet strings, are pulled by George Soros. I don't know. Hey, I read a lot of articles online. I try to assimilate the ones that are from reputable sources. I read the Washington Post articles, the ones that are universally important. I'll post them on the political group, Uncensored Hard-Hitting Truth. But there are a great deal of misinformation on the internet. Mm. Now, does that mean I'm giving credit to mainstream media on cable TV? Hell no. I have boycotted them a long time ago. I don't watch mainstream media anymore since the way they treated Bernie Sanders. And that was the end. I boycott their sponsors, and I boycott them. So that's that.
CNN the other day got caught leading a person being interviewed. In other words, like telling them what to say. CNN.
Coaching them, like encouraging them.
Yes.
Yeah. Hey, for all I know, on the Jerry Springer show, there's probably people holding up big cue cards for the audience.
They're holding up chairs to hit them, everybody over the head.
No, I mean the audience does things in unison.
Ah, yeah. Well, that's
simultaneously.
Could
be. They, you know.
That could be.
You know, they all clap at the same time. They go Jerry, Jerry at the same time.
It's all scripted.
Yeah, they probably tell the guests in the back waiting room, lay it on real thick. Scream, yell, jump up and down, make like you're gonna have a fist fight.
Yeah.
Ratings.
I don't know. I always wonder when people say that. How can they say ratings if you are watching the show? And the show is doing whatever they say to gain ratings. How are you gaining ratings from the show that you're watching?
Well, they want you to
Yeah, but how are you going to bring in other people to watch the show so the ratings go up?
No, they want you to be there.
You're already there.
They want you to be there so you can see the sponsors, the commercials.
Yeah, but I'm talking about when they talk ratings.
Well, ratings means an attraction, like you were telling me about the barker at a carnival.
Yeah,
the
but
barker.
I'm saying, the show is on,
yeah.
The audience is there. How does this now bring new ratings? It doesn't, and it can't.
You mean new people?
Correct.
No, because it only attracts that segment of the population who enjoys that kind of...
You're not attracting anybody while the show is going on. You've already got your audience.
Well
what are you going to attract?
Well,
somebody who's channel surfing?
No, they do promos.
But who is going to listen to them except the people that are there?
No, what
already?
I mean is Jerry Springer and other shows like Jerry Springer. Jerry Springer has a lot of spinoffs. Okay, Steve Wilkos, who was his security guy, so on and so forth. Bill Cunningham.
That's promos.
Right. They'll give you clips in a commercial, the clips of all the big fights and brawls.
But that has nothing to do with the particular show that is on at the time. That is going to bring
no,
in new ratings.
That's just channel surfing. Channel surfers.
Maybe. Channel surfing, so you got a couple new
it's
people
like,
come on.
All right. It's like, for instance, all right. I didn't even know that progressive there was a progressive cable station from, what is it, Democracy Now?
Oh, I saw it. No, I saw that on the internet the other day. Yeah,
They have a cable station now.
What's my Amy?
The one with the long straight poker straight gray hair.
Amy Goodman.
I didn't know that they had a cable station until I found it, totally by accident, and I found it during the Chicago. It wasn't Chicago. It was in, it might have been an Indiana primary, or there was some primary, there was a primary going on in the Midwest. And there was a lot of protesting outside. And of course, the mainstream media did not show you the protest.
Of course not.
The Republican that's it. The Republican National Convention for this year. That's when I discovered Amy Goodwin and the Goodman and the Democracy Now cable station. The Republican National Convention was, where was it? It was it Indiana? Or in Ohio somewhere?
No, Indiana.
It was Indiana? And there were tons of people out there marching, man, but you would never know it if you just watched mainstream media. That's when I stumbled on it. Now, if you are an
organ...
Huh?
Did you hurt your toe?
No. I didn't stub it. Stumbled.
Okay.
You know, channel surf stumbling. If you're very important organization, very informative, educational, and progressive, and you decide to buy a cable station that's way up yonder, like there's like probably thousands of cable stations now. It goes up pretty high. The point is, you're only going to catch channel surfers because you're not going to have the funding to advertise. So you're only going to catch people that are going bleep 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 with the remote.
And who the hell is going to go over 600 and 700?
I don't know anybody that does. I mean, unless you're totally bored and you're just going beep 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 pop beep. Oh, what's this?
Ah.
Beep 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 beep. Oh, what's that? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you're going up that high. Now, you said that Gary Null said he bought a station.
That's what I heard.
On cable.
That's what I heard.
It's probably one of those high numbers, but the good thing about Gary Null's new station is that Gary Null has a lot of people that go to the Progressive Radio Network website and Facebook page, and he will... He can advertise the hell out of it there and get all of his legions to go to the station. That's the great thing about it. Now, I gotta congratulate him, even though we bucked heads in the past. I gotta congratulate him, Gary Null, for buying the station, because it gets the truth, the real hard-hitting truth, not only online, but on cable. So I gotta give him credit. Anyway, I know we were very long-winded. Let us sink our teeth into these readings before lunch.
After 2 years of heavy casualties, the Afghan military is trying to retake the initiative in the war against militants with a new offensive against Islamic State Group loyalists. An assault that will see American troops back on the battlefield, working more closely with Afghan soldiers.
And
so it looks like we'll never get out of our longest war of all time.
Yeah, they surpassed Vietnam, all right? Or they might.
15 years.
Now, all of these squabbles, all of these civil wars in these countries probably have went on for centuries, for all we know. Must the United States get involved in every little squabble and civil war everywhere? Or maybe the 800 American military bases is all connected to the military-industrial complex. And maybe it's just one immense revolving door of profit.
Yeah,
perhaps.
There's back to the what we were talking about before.
Right.
I mean, that's more money available, isn't it? All the waste from the Pentagon.
And their satanic human sacrifices, of course, for profit are the young people, men and women of poor and middle class families, because the rich kids are certainly not going to go.
No, they get deferments like Trump.
Yeah, well, he's special. He's special. He's
there. You go.
He's a rich kid.
Afghan President Ashraf Ghani recently announced a major assault against fighters loyal to ISIS, who over the past year captured positions along Afghanistan's eastern border with Pakistan, mainly in Nangarhar province.
Yeah, and we all know Pakistan is like a U.S., quote-unquote, U.S. ally, just like Saudi Arabia is, with quotation marks.
So we do have a base in Pakistan, though. During the Iraq War, I think we paid them $10 billion a year or whatever.
Are they bought off lovers? Would you consider Pakistan a bought off lover?
Absolutely, but they hate our guts.
Saudi Arabia?
But they hate our guts.
And Saudi too.
Saudi Arabia too.
Well, they sure, United States, the Obama administration sure pissed off Iran after trying to make nice with them. Because now they're in league with Vladimir Putin, and so is China. China had a big meeting with Vladimir Putin. So now the Gog and Magog is pretty damn big, huh?
Yeah. 200 million man army.
You might as well include Russia and Iran does not like anyone to put them with the Middle East. So they are Asia. They are an Asian country. They are Persian, and I believe they are part of that king of the was it king of the east, or they just call
no,
it Gog
king
and,
of the south.
They just call it Gog and Magog.
No, Iran is not part of that. Iran is the king of the south.
Oh, it's
along with Egypt, along with some many of those other countries over there.
So Islamic, you're putting them with Islamic extremists?
They will head it.
Islamic
they are the head.
Not Saudi?
According to the Bible.
Not Saudi Arabia?
No.
Okay.
No.
Well, they...
Yeah. Saudi Arabia is Sunni. Iran is Shia.
Oh, Shiites. Yeah.
That goal to uproot ISIS from Afghanistan has taken on new urgency in the wake of a deadly suicide bombing of a protest march Saturday in Kabul that killed 80 people. The Islamic State group's AMA online news agency quickly claimed responsibility for the attack, the first ISIS attack in the Afghan capital. Isn't that funny?
Really?
The United States Army is there for 15 years, and now ISIS is there.
So ISIS is taking the place of the Muslim extremists. Islam extremists that were established in Afghanistan. So
that was the Taliban.
That was the Taliban. But
and Mr. Bin Laden.
Bin Laden. But it looks like it's all becoming ISIS.
Yeah. But the American military's there.
You said
what are they doing? Sitting on their goddamn asses in their bases?
You said Al-Qaeda became part of ISIS. They collectively, right?
Well, I guess some of the people from it, you know.
Well, their agendas are similar.
Well, who knows what ISIS is made up of. The point is, how did they get in Afghanistan with the American military there? That's the point.
Yeah, who's watching the border?
Who's
borders?
Watching the store?
Who's mining the store? Right. They're just collecting taxpayers' money with their thumbs up their ass. I mean,
that's what it looks like. The inexperienced Afghan forces, after 15 years, by the way, inexperienced, have largely stalled in the fight against Islamic militants ever since most international combat troops withdrew in 2014. American forces that remained shifted to a supporting role and U.S. airstrikes diminished, letting the Afghan military take the lead in carrying out the war. Taliban forces have dominated the battlefield, and the Islamic State group has been building a foothold.
Foothold.
And that has meant mounting losses among Afghan troops. Casualty numbers are not officially released, but according to figures provided by military officials, at least 5,000 troops were killed in 2014. Raising to more than 6,000 last year. In an acknowledgement of the deteriorating security situation, President Obama last month gave a green light to a more assertive role for U.S. troops. Though still short of direct combat, with that boost, Afghans are shifting back on the offensive. The anti-ISIS operation announced by Ghani, dubbed Shafwak, or Dawn, in Pashto, will see the head of U.S. and NATO forces in Afghanistan, General John Nicholson, implementing a aggressive new strategy.
Oh, really?
Oh, 15 years later, we get aggressive?
Now it's aggressive, yeah.
Ooh. U.S. airstrikes on Afghanistan are likely to become more frequent as this tragedy shifts from using air power only to defend U.S. and NATO positions to striking in support of Afghan offensives. Nangarhar is one of Afghanistan's most economically important provinces, a major producer of agricultural goods and thoroughfare for much of the country's exports to Pakistan and beyond. It's like a second capital. Afghan Army General Sher Mohammad Karimi said. It is a gateway to Kabul. If Nangarhar falls, Kabul will become a battleground every day.
Hey, and so is Syria, and so on and so on. And so on for years and years and years to come.
That's what it looks like.
a potential, very possible, World War III can very easily happen if the wrong people are elected in the United States.
And getting back to the bases around the world.
Yeah.
We love dictators. We like to sign up with dictators in these countries. Okay?
Because they're more it's easier to do business with them?
Yes. Yes, now, more stable economically.
So when they, when a dictator sees all that cash in front of his nose, they it's very easy to make a deal with him.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Because they love the mullah.
Yep.
Gotcha.
For the first time since declaring his presidential run, Donald Trump expressed regret for saying things that may have hurt people. Sometimes in the heat of debate,
it's true,
and speaking on a multitude of issues, you don't choose the right words or you say the wrong thing. I have done that.
Well, I don't have a problem with him bashing his political opponents, because politicians are sleazebags anyway and liars. I have a problem when he bashes particular segments of the voting population. That's the problem.
Trump was reading from prepared text. He said it in a rally in Charlotte, North Carolina. And believe it or not, I regret it.
Believe it
particularly
or not.
Where I have caused personal pain.
Well, him, Donald Trump, kowtowing to the rest of the Republican Party and moving a little farther to the right is not a good move as far as the mainstream population goes, as far as we the people. Not good news at all.
Too much is at stake for us to be consumed with these issues. As the crowd cheered, Trump pledged to always tell the truth.
Always?
Always.
Always. Is the word always in like microscopic font?
No.
It's normal font, right?
That's correct.
Oh, man. You know what I smell? I smell the aroma of a salsiccia, peppers, and onions. Yeah. Like the Italian festival. I get that aroma right now.
The remarks
Sausage.
Came as Trump makes significant changes to a campaign that has struggled since the Democratic and Republican nominating conventions from self-created distractions. Earlier Thursday, Trump moved to invest nearly $5 million in battleground state advertising to address daunting challenges in the states that will make or break his White House ambitions.
Well,
he also shook up his campaign in recent days, tapping a new combative conservative media executive, Stephen Bannon, to serve as CEO of the campaign.
Stephen Bannon. Yeah, I heard it.
Yeah, he's with Breitbart.
I heard Bannon is like outspoken, like him.
He's a right-wing nut.
I was putting it mildly, yeah.
Well, is that outspoken? Yeah.
Well, I know about the banyan tree that grows in the tropics, and it's a very unusual, weird tree, so maybe it goes with this guy. But anyway, are we ready for lunch? Not that I particularly am hungry or starving. It's that I need to go to the men's room, and you need to eat. So yeah. we're gonna break for lunch, and now you will be met by announcer William H. Morrow III with promo and how to defeat a conservative Bible verses. Simply hit the pause button, read, and learn. If you're capable of doing that today, Americans, I don't know. We'll see.
I'm William Marlborough. Wake up, people, because the truth is often, a very, very hard pill to swallow. Hi, this is William H. Morrow. The best way to join our organization is to get your free annual subscription to Newsletter Censored with your gift to support this work. The newsletter of hard-hitting truth and news fighting censorship and conservative propaganda since 1977. There is nothing out there like the Newsletter Censored in the mainstream media or the press. This newsletter is the very best way to join and be a part of our organization. We're living the end times, so you need Newsletter Censored. Go to www.newslettercensored.com. Hey, listen, for the real hard-hitting truth, you need Newsletter Censored. And now, back to the show. Bye-bye.
Okay.
Thank you very much, William Hamilton Morrow III, for doing promo. We're back. This is Progressive Discussions. I'm your host, James P. Madonna. I'm with the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman. And gentleman Jack called me, and he has a hearing at the federal courthouse in Newark for his Social Security disability,
ooh,
SSD claim. And his lawyer told him that they will throw so many questions at him, and he is not to volunteer any information.
Just very good.
Answer them. And then stop talking.
Do not elaborate.
Answer them and stop talking. But they will try every which way to find a reason, excuse to deny him Social Security disability. But I'm sure if he was a corporation, if he was a corporate CEO, they will not throw questions at him. They will
throw money at him.
Throw vast amounts of taxpayers' money in his direction if he was an American corporate CEO.
There you go.
But because he's a little schmuck, a little putz, they will put him through the sausage, the meat grinder.
The ringer.
The ringer.
Yeah.
To try to dissect him and find reasons to deny him. The American system, since day one, since the Industrial Revolution, capitalism is the tool of Satan. It is the devil's economics. Pure capitalism is crony capitalism. It's greedy. It's evil. There's nothing good about it. It was always rigged for the rich. Now, let us finish up with the balance of the show.
The whining supporters of the Republican Party, and presumably Donald Trump, is beginning to reach new lows.
Oh, their whine is all right.
The writer, in stating that celebrities should not comment on the presidential election, seems to forget that we do have a freedom of speech in this country.
Yes.
What struck me about the letter is that the writer only named celebrities who support Hillary Clinton. Could it be that she can't find A-list celebrities supporting Trump and therefore neglected to add the names of Antonio Sabato and Scott Baio?
You mean to tell me Antonio Sabato, the one with this Mexican guy with the dimples, Latino man with the dimples, is actually a right-wing conservative?
I guess so.
Hasn't he forgotten his roots?
Maybe. Or maybe he doesn't want to acknowledge them. There are people like that when they get it made, you know.
You mean like...
They don't like to know where they came from.
Like conservative blacks?
Yeah.
Like Herman Cain?
Funny you should mention that.
Herman Cain.
999.
Ben Carson. Ben Carson and others like him?
Yeah.
Who forget where they came from, who forget... quickly forget, and that right-wing Republican Asian woman from Hawaii, very attractive, that forgot her roots too.
Yeah. I may disagree with Sabato and Bayo.
I mean, Philippine-looking woman, brown-skinned Asian woman.
But certainly have no problem with their speaking their mind. The fact is that the Republican Party has nominated arguably the most unqualified candidate for the presidency since Warren G. Harding.
Yeah, well, none of the two are good.
His sole platform consists of making outrageous statements to whet the anger and bias of his base and to try to deflect them from voters that his policies would ruin our country our relationships with our allies.
Yeah, at least Hillary Clinton thinks highly of Obamacare. The Republicans haven't come up with their replacement for Obamacare.
Aetna pulled out, you know.
Yeah, because they're allowed to discriminate, yeah. Right? Because insurance companies are allowed to pull out?
Yeah.
They should really be
Two
forced.
Pulled out already.
Huh?
Two of them pulled out.
Because I mean, isn't it like is it possible to force them not to discriminate against the poor folk?
Not according to the deal that was made through Obamacare. No.
So they're allowed to pull out and discriminate.
Yeah.
Okay, and they did. Aetna did. Yeah.
That was one of the wrong. That was the wrong thing to allow them to write the law.
They're fucking lucky.
Okay.
They're fucking lucky. They still exist because they could have all been bye-bye, belly up in the first 2 years of the Obama term when he was elected. The first 2 years we could have had single payer universal health care, and they would have been out on their ass.
Mm-hmm. A man who belittles Gold Star parents and calls our president a terrorist founder deserves no consideration to lead this country.
Gold Star?
Yeah, when their son dies in the war.
Is that what that means?
Yeah.
Gold Star parents? Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. The Islamic couple.
H-A-H-N.
Who lost his son, their son.
Captain, yeah. Yeah, he may try, started trouble fighting with him.
That's kind of heartless.
Stupid. I recognize that all politicians can play fast and loose with the truth. But I've never witnessed anyone who fails to tell the truth as much as Trump. I applaud anyone who speaks out against Trump. If you don't like what Trump critics say, don't listen. But I believe some are just refusing to hear the truth.
It's like suspecting George Takei's parents of being Japanese spies during World War II, when the Japanese Americans were thrown into these internment camps, totally Americanized Japanese Americans. I mean, you can't, and especially since these Muslim parents lost their son. I mean, he didn't show any compassion, empathy for them?
No. Have you seen Donald Trump show empathy for anybody?
Well, he wanted to close...
I haven't seen it.
He wanted to close down all mosques in the United States.
Well, that's just for Muslims, but I'm saying, have you seen him, except for his daughter Ivanka, with that statement that he made?
That he wanted to bang Ivanka?
Yeah, well, if she wasn't my daughter...
A lot of people want to bang Ivanka.
You know,
it's a big deal.
Donald Trump is being criticized by establishment politicians for not being presidential enough.
Presidential.
What's so ironic about this so-called advice is that many of them are losers themselves.
Yeah, take a look at them. They go to the rally, they're fat, they have no shirt on, and they have the Confederate flag behind them.
The letter writer in the above subject asks, where are the Romneys and McCains?
Oh, wow. That's a prize package for you.
Yes, they were presidential. And John McCain is also a war hero.
Aw, come on.
But apparently it didn't matter.
Because he was captured?
They still lost and ran failed campaigns.
How is he a hero if he's a POW?
Mitt Romney's image as a disconnected rich guy was so bad, his campaign was forced to publish photos of him flipping pancakes in his kitchen.
He was flipping pancakes. I'm sure he has hired people that work in at his residence, his mansion, to do that. He just decided that was a photo op, right?
Ironing his shirts and kissing babies to prove he's just a regular guy.
Well, G.W. Bush, remember that photo of him making face? The baby was crying. He was picking up the baby and the baby was crying. And he was making a funny face.
Trump is still attracting tens of thousands of supporters to his rallies, and he still has the support of the millions of voters who elected him as the Republican nominee.
A lot of middle-class people that choose to blame everything on the poor instead of corporations.
Why should he now be forced to take advice from the losing politicians, many of whom are has-beens? It was reported recently that about 100 Republican leaders are abandoning Trump because they don't approve of his campaign tactics. Big deal! I think Trump should just concentrate on keeping the support of his millions of fans, who are way more important than a few establishment politicians, who were never in his corner in the first place. Best advice for Trump comes from old Billy Joel tune, Just the Way You Are.
We love you just the way you are.
Lyrics include, don't go changing to try to please me. You never let me down before. I'll take the good times, I'll take the bad times.
That was kind of...
I'll take you just the way you are.
I don't like sappy songs. They make me nauseous. I don't care if it's that song or Karen Carpenter. I don't like any sappy songs. You know, they make me very... Nauseous. Yeah, now I know some middle class people that just won't answer me when it comes to the top 1% and corporate CEOs. They continue to blame the poor. They continue to blame the poor on social services. They won't even attack the rich.
Never.
And they are middle-class people that have mortgages and children to support.
And they'll never be anything more than what they are now when they croak.
No, some of them, like I know one that was started out as a lower middle class and now is actually income-wise, is actually upper middle class now.
Good for him.
But
is he a George Soros?
But they were humble when they were lower middle class. They were humble. Now now the person talks right wing.
Hey, there's an old saying.
You know what I mean, Jelly Bean?
As a young man, you are a liberal. As an older man, you are a conservative.
Why?
Because you earned money.
Because you're not, it's the problem, you don't have the problem anymore. In other words, if it's not your problem, once it becomes not your problem anymore, You don't give a shit.
And you want to protect your what you have, your money.
Your nest egg, yeah.
Your nest
yeah,
egg, yeah. Whatever.
And they also, the person also doesn't want to put out any consumer videos or, you know, bashing corporations. It's just a sudden... A sudden change.
Adaptive supporters.
It's a sudden
change. They will never rock the boat.
No, I mean, as the income rose, mm-hmm. and as they became more financially established, they became more like pro-capitalism, pro-Republican, pro-corporation.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That's the same.
You know, it's like a person who you grew up, that's from your block, from your neighborhood. They became a celebrity, a big star, and you stopped hearing from them. Yeah. And you try to send them a message. And they don't return your message.
They send you a message. Don't bother me.
Anthony Laura told me about someone that... he knew very well, and because they kind of like hit the big time, they won't even acknowledge his messaging, his mm-hmm. email. Not even one word, not even or ooga booga, nothing.
There you go.
You think maybe the people that have made it big are afraid that their friends from the old days will ask them for money?
Yeah.
You think that's a possibility, Reverend Bill?
Yeah.
The same thing with Shakira's mother breaking off all contact with her relatives from Barranquilla, Colombia?
Yeah.
They're afraid the people from the old country will ask them for moolah?
Yeah.
Now that they have rich and fame?
Mm-hmm.
Fame and riches? Oh, okay. Gotcha.
Good news for bookworms.
Bookworms? Books are out of style.
A new study finds...
They're not in vogue anymore,
that books. Reading every day could increase longevity.
So can antioxidants and uncle-oxidants.
Researchers from Yale University found that reading a book... for 30 minutes per day could lower the risk of death by 20%.
That's if there's nobody to bother you. If there's no one to bother you, if there's no one to call your name and you know, bug you, you can read.
Well,
yes.
Fortunately,
yes.
I read more than that every day, but yeah. Not as much as I would like or I used to.
I understand.
Past studies have linked reading with long-term cognitive benefits, such as the delay of Alzheimer's. By the way, speaking of Alzheimer's, Trumpy has it in his family.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Hey, maybe reading is equivalent, is like your brain doing dumbbell curls.
That's exactly what it is. Exercise.
Yeah.
But this study suggests reading benefits the physical body and overall health as well.
Yeah, chess too. I bet chess is exercise.
Absolutely. The study was published in the journal Social Science and Medicine and looked at the data of more than 3,600 participants in the health and retirement study, honing in on participants' reading habits. The prolonged life results due to reading remain constant regardless of other factors such as wealth, age, sex, health issues, depression, race, and more. Other reading materials such as newspapers or magazines did have a similar outcome.
Similar?
Though nowhere near as pronounced as with books.
Well, rest in peace, Burgess Meredith. Mr. Wordsworth on the Twilight Zone episode, the librarian.
Who's obsolete?
You are obsolete. Librarian, does that mean you deal with books? Yes, books. Mr. Chancellor. Is that his name, Mr. Chancellor?
Yeah.
Books. Dictators don't like people having books.
Oh, that is correct. They don't like people having ideas.
No independent free thinkers there.
There you go. A little change of pace here.
Tomato paste.
I am 32 years old and divorced my wife 2 years ago. Although I tried dating for a bit, it was a brave new world online apps and profiles. It wasn't for me. I became discouraged.
Yeah, well, people lie, people embellish, people twist reality in their profiles.
A year has gone by,
yeah,
and female friends are telling me I need to get back out and date. Yeah.
They also use fake profile, not fake photos per se, but photos that are hiding something. Like, it could be a faraway photo of them where you can't make out their face. It could be an old blurry one. It could be a photo that just shows them from the chin up, which means they're obese. They're hiding something.
I find the whole endeavor depressing.
Frustrating, too.
And prefer to spend my time elsewhere. And single.
Well, he's like me. He doesn't really like clubs. You know, nightclubs. Crowded, noisy nightclubs.
They say my decision to stay single is emotionally driven, and I deserve love. My argument against dating is that I wasn't a good husband, and I have no interest in devoting the time or energy to date in the scary and confusing world of the web. Can you settle this dispute so that we can stop the back and forth arguments?
Well, that's a whole talk show. I mean, there are women that are insecure, that demand 100% of a man's attention all the time, where he can't have hobbies and friends. There are women that are not insecure, that treat you as an equal partner, but that's rare. You know what I mean? It depends on the compatibility. I mean, you shouldn't have to give up what makes you a person, what makes you you. You shouldn't have to sacrifice that. You know, and you shouldn't have to be with a control freak either. And also dating for the wrong reason, like a gold digger dating a man with money. All right, go ahead.
Dear AB's answer, I agree that opening up yourself to strangers can be scary. If you are not interested in meeting women on the internet, I won't force you. Even though that's how many, although not all, relationships start these days.
Yes, that's absolutely true. It's because it's more scientific. I mean, it's not perfect, just, you know.
Because that's not your cup of tea. There are other ways to meet nice women. Among them, getting out and participating in activities you enjoy, or volunteering for a cause you believe in.
It's true, having things in common. Yeah, with others.
Of course, that necessitates being open to having a relationship with someone and believing you deserve one.
And hopefully there's someone there that tickles your fancy or whatever, you know. You have to have physical chemistry.
From the tone of your letter, I'm not sure that you're there yet. Not having been a good husband the first time is no excuse. If you have learned from your mistakes.
It can be very frustrating because it only works as well as the honesty of the profiles. You know? I mean, some women in their profiles have a long list of their requirements.
Hey.
Very nitpicky. But what do they bring to the table when those that have a very long list of demands? You know?
Earth just roiled to its hottest month in recorded history, according to NASA.
Listen to this.
Even after the fading of a strong El Niño, which spikes global temperatures on top of man-made climate change, July burst global temperature records.
Hey, Iran had dangerously high heat at one time this year. Very high, I mean, like...
It was like 115 or something.
No, it was higher. No, it was...
More than that.
No, it was pretty high. It was pretty high. Some articles made it ridiculously high, which I didn't believe. But no, overall, we had a bad summer. I mean, as far as the planet goes, yeah.
NASA calculated that July was 1.51 degrees Fahrenheit warmer than 1950 through 1980. That's clearly hotter than the previous hotter months, about 0.18 degree warmer than the previous record of July 2011 to July 2015, which were so close, they were said to be in a tie for the hottest month on record. Scientists blame mostly man-made climate change, from the burning of fossil fuels, with an extra jump from the now-gone El Niño, which every few years is a natural warming of parts of the Pacific Ocean that changes weather worldwide. Georgia Tech climate scientist Kim Cobb said this is significant because global temperatures continue to warm even as a record-breaking El Niño event has finally released its grip.
Wouldn't it be funny if Kim Cobb had a son named him Cornelius Cobb? Now, as a kid, I remember upper 90s and with humidity, slightly over 100 with humidity, but nothing beyond that. It's bad enough we have humidity, which is makes it feel hotter. But
NASA's five hottest months on record are July 2016, July 2011, July 2015, July 2009, August 2014. Only July 2015 was during an El Niño. Records go back to 8. This is the 10th record hot month in a row.
Yeah, and usually, unfortunately, when you have record hot summers, you have record winters. And the old Farmer's Almanac says we are going to have a very bad winter of 2017.
The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, which calculates temperatures slightly differently, will come out with its July figures on Wednesday. NOAA has figured there have been 14 monthly heat records broken in a row before July.
Incredible. Well, you know, the right wing still put out articles online about the ice sheet growing faster, expanding faster than ever before. And then you see other photos of the poor polar bear sitting on its little ice floe you know, with nowhere to go.
No food.
You know, it's like, I guess, you know what? I guess greed is an obsession where the planet could be dying, the people, the human race could be endangered, but I guess they feel that if the worst comes to worst, they can always eat their money.
No, they are selfish. They do not think of others.
They don't think of we or us.
That
they
is correct.
Think of me, me, me.
They do not
me,
think
me.
Of community. They do not think of the commons. They do not think of people in general. They think only of themselves. That is capitalism.
It's the get way of life.
Correct.
Not the give. But they don't look at the overall picture of what's happening.
Correct.
They only know, they're very myopic, you know, short-sighted. How much is going into my pocket or bank account? How much, regardless how I get it, how crooked they are, as long as they are getting more money. And even if they're multi-billionaires, obviously it's not enough. Then it becomes a power obsession. You know, after you're a multi-billionaire many times over, yeah. Then I am assuming it becomes a power obsession.
The poor in America have always been invisible.
Yeah, and the homeless poor too, even more invisible.
This phenomenon was noted in Michael Harrington's book, The Other America, Poverty in America. Published in 1962.
Oh, really? Oh, wow. Oh, during the Civil Rights Movement.
Harrington's book inspired President John F. Kennedy's advice to Americans to
ask not what their country can do for them, but what they could do for their country.
Isn't that kind of Republican sounding when he said that?
Yeah. Well, let's apply it to that gentleman going for his Social Security disability.
Yeah.
Don't ask our government for your Social Security disability.
Unless you're a CEO.
Let's find out what you can do for your country.
Which means what you can
Maybe
do.
I got her. You could give your life in the military.
What you can do for your country, what they really mean is what you can do for a corporation and be a drone, a slave to us.
A wage slave, yeah. And President Lyndon B. Johnson to initiate the war on poverty. Now, 54 years after the publication of Harrington's book, the focus has shifted to a discussion of economic equity in society. Regrettably, the fact that 15% of Americans still live in poverty has once again become
poverty
invisible.
Yeah, and Bernie Sanders has mentioned this quite a bit in his campaign before he decided to endorse Hillary Clinton about the inequality in income of wealth. The distribution of wealth is extremely unfair, and I think higher crime rate is a product of poverty.
Well, it is in some instances.
I think it isn't
when you got two bankers robbing each other or whatever, or robbing us.
Yeah.
Then it's not applicable, but, you know.
But it is a fact that poor people have more children, which is going against their environment. You know, if you're...
Well, yeah, if you can't afford, one, how can you afford more than one?
Right, unless they're just so bored out of their minds that they fuck all the time.
Or maybe they don't learn about, like Bristol Palin. She's pissed off because people are getting a sex education.
Chubby little slut.
Yeah.
Bristol, who loves the pistol.
and probably didn't get in any information.
Brazen Bristol.
About how to, you know, avoid pregnancy.
Brazen Bristol, who loves the pistol, she is lecturing. Whoa. She's lecturing other millennials to stay celibate. Oh, that's realistic.
It's time to declare another war on poverty and to attack the root causes of this epidemic that still festers in American society.
Political corruption, greed, I mean, everything going to the top.
And working for someone else.
Going to everything going to the, all the wealth pooling at the top, top 1%. No trickle down happening. But they keep on telling that lie about trickle-down economics.
To be believed, they're going to continue telling it.
Hey, even with the outsourced American jobs, big deal. It's trickling down in Bangladesh. It's trickling down in the Philippines with our office jobs being there, customer service. It's trickling down in China. What's trickling down? The people are getting peanuts. They're getting next to nothing. They're getting with no benefits. Big deal. What are you trickling down? There is no trickle anywhere. It's all pooling at the top. Friends of mine in the Philippines that live there said, no wonder so many American businessmen are traveling here. They said that there's a lot of factories and offices are opening up here. With Americans in suits. My answer was, those are the outsourced American jobs. And when they trickle overseas, it's really pissle. Trickle dickle.
But the real problem is constantly overlooked. You won't get rich by making someone else rich. By working for them.
Someone else. That is very true.
Okay.
That's real trickling down. 50 cents to a dollar an hour for a customer service office employee. Oh, that's real trickling down in the Philippine Islands. You know. But no, you won't. You'll never get ahead working for someone else.
I am a 40-year-old man. Divorced with teenage children.
I feel sorry for him.
And have been exclusively dating a woman who has a 4-year-old daughter.
Mommy, wah, wah, mommy, pay attention to me, wah, wah.
There have been no clashes between our children. We have yet to have sex.
How long have they been together? So this doesn't sound good.
Don't say.
Because the fucking kids prevent sexual activity. I'm telling you, they're the biggest cock blockers around.
When I'm over at her place.
The kids up all night. I know.
I sleep on the living room floor.
What?
Either on an inflatable air mattress.
Does this little girl have her own room, or does she sleep
with mommy? Or in a sleeping bag.
Or does she sleep with mommy? Oh, this don't sound good. And he's still with her?
Either way, I feel like I'm left to sleep on a dog bed.
Guy's a chooch.
Not great for my self-esteem, as you can imagine.
Self-esteem? He's an idiot.
My girlfriend uses her daughter as the reason. Suggesting that the girl just wouldn't understand me sleeping in mommy's
bed. Who gives a fuck? You make her understand. You make her understand. Discipline. This is the fault of modern day millennial and Generation X parenting. No discipline. The kids control the parents.
I don't personally see it as being a big issue for the daughter. Given how long we have been together, we have discussed the subject, and she makes reference to perhaps planning some sort of a rendezvous.
But it never seems to take place.
I hope Ron King watches this last segment of the show, because he's going to get upset too. Yeah, I'm telling you, they control the parents, the modern day parents.
There are no religious issues here. My girlfriend did have a promiscuous and troubled past as a young adult, so I'm sensitive to the issue, but this is driving me nuts.
And another thing is, they'll let the kids stay up real late. And then when the kids finally do go to sleep, the woman is like real tired. I think I'm gonna go to bed. Can I walk you to the door? I mean, I used to blame it all on the young children, but no, I blame it all on the modern day parents, on the younger parents. They have no balls, they have no spine. There is no discipline whatsoever. They do not establish themselves as the alpha, as the parent. The children rule. Everything's about the kids. And you know what? This woman is going to be without a man for a long time, because, I mean, only a stupid little sap that, you know, is going to put up with it. Really, I mean. I can't see anybody putting up with this.
People usually find the time to do the things they want to do.
Absolutely.
Your girlfriend may be holding out for marriage, not have a strong sex drive, or not be as attracted to you as you are to her.
That's very possible. Look, there's time. If there's a will, there's a way. People can and will find the time to do many things. To pick up a phone and call you, even if it's only 5 minutes. Sex. There's always a way if there's a will. Go ahead, finish up.
You didn't mention how long you have been seeing this lady, but I think it's a time you discussed your feelings with her again. Find out exactly why your sexual relationship hasn't gone from theory to practice. And take your cue from there.
Communication is extremely important in relationships. The lack of communication is one of the biggest problems. You know, not everybody is a mind reader. They're not psychic mediums, can read your mind. You know, you gotta sit down and present the problem. Now, if the person argues with you, then you're not going anywhere. Then it's not going to go anywhere. You know what I mean? I mean, if you say it in a nice way, and they take offense to it, then you can't reason with them. But that's it. Get it over with. Nip it in the bud. Don't date her month after month after month after month.
Same thing.
Nip it in the bud. You know. What is that different definition of insanity if you do the same thing over and over again and expect a different result?
Yeah.
Anyway, thank you for joining us for Progressive Discussions. We'll see you next time. Thank you.
At least we have better lighting this time.
Oh, whoop-dee-doo.
Whoop-dee-doo.
This has been a Megalife 21 production.